here right now, here right now, making this place I stand holy ground, holy ground. Your spirit moves and breathes all around, all around, all good and perfect things flowing down, flowing down. If all of the heavens are singing along with the saints and the elders in glorious song, and the praises they sing never seem to get old, then I'll stay here forever singing, holy, holy, holy Lord. God Almighty over all. You were, and you'll be forever the King enthroned in glorious splendor. Holy, holy Lord. Gentle love calling me closer still, closer still. Jesus, you're guiding me to your will, to your will. If all of the heavens are singing along with the saints and the elders in glorious song, and the praises they sing never seem to get old, then I'll stay here forever singing, holy, holy, holy Lord. God Almighty over all. You be forever the King enthroned in glorious splendor. Holy, holy Lord. God Almighty over all. You are, and you'll be forever
Would you please stand and join us? If you're uncomfortable standing in here, you're welcome to go to the foyer. We just want to make everybody safe and secure. So please join us.
Here we go.
We stand and lift up our heads, for the joy of the Lord is our strength. We bow down and worship Him now. How great, everyone sing.
pray with me? Heavenly Father, it's good and it's joyful to be here in your place. We just ask that your Spirit will come among us and touch each one that is here. We know with everything that's going on in this world, Father, that you are there amongst us. You're our hope and our strength and our comfort and our love. And we just give you this service, Father, with all those that are here today. We honor and we love you and we bow down and we worship you today. In Jesus' holy name, amen. You may be seated.
She's going to announce her.
Okay, I have a few announcements this morning. Just a reminder that today is our 2 cents offering, and the bowl is in the foyer for you to place your change in it. The June Evangelism Challenge is gas cards. We will be collecting money and gas cards in the basket at the back for Sandy to pass out to those that need it. And also, in the last couple of weeks, the newsletter has went out for online. And if you're having trouble opening it, just let Tonda know, and she will get you a hard copy. And that's all I have today.
Okay, at this time, if I could have Alex and Gavin make their way up front, please. Hi, buddy. Gavin. Nice shoes, by the way.
Thank you.
Yeah. We have similar shoes. I just wanted to, this morning we want to honor our graduates. Both Gavin and Alex have been a part of our church from the time they were born. I had the privilege of being able to see them grow up most of their life. And so it's been a true honor to witness that and to be a part of these young men and their lives and what they've become. They both are just, Alex has always been one to, he's super smart and he's always had a plan. He likes to have fun, but he likes to, he's just a good guy. Let's just say that. He's a really good guy. Gavin, you're super smart as well. You've got a lot of potential, both of you guys do. The stuff that you've taught me about your pigs has been amazing. I didn't know there, all the things that you've taught me a lot with pigs, let's just say that. I didn't know there's a lot of the stuff that you've said. I'm like, okay. But some interesting things. All the pigs have personalities, and yours definitely have had the most from what I've heard, personality-wise. But I want to take this time to hear a little bit about your story and kind of what has gotten you to where you're at. Let's ask this question to both of you. What is your favorite time or favorite thing about high school, like in the past? So each just kind of share your story or multiple stories. You can step up to the mic and actually use that. Yeah.
Well, being done is one that I'm one of my fondest memories. I spent a lot of time with everybody. Alex, basically, from flag football, something like that. So seeing everybody kind of grow up and decide where life's going to take them next. So that would be one of mine.
I think that my favorite memory was just walking through the hallways when I was younger, just seeing everybody and like the upcoming seniors and the seniors that we had then. Just seeing what they were going to be going and doing and how the school's environment changed over the years because it's always different every year, and this year was no exception.
Okay, you might as well stay there, Alex. I'll ask you next. What is your, besides me, what was your most favorite thing with youth group?
I think my favorite thing with youth group was just the connection. On how everybody kind of understood where people were coming from, and it wasn't such a big youth group, so we really knew more about each other instead of just going with 30 other kids and not exactly understanding the stories that they have and where they come from. So.
Awesome.
So I'd have to agree with Alex there. You definitely have to have a personality when you walk into that room because you get a lot of conversation, and you have to explain yourself very detailed. And so, yeah, it's just a great atmosphere. But I mean, one of my favorite memories of Michael is running around at Upwards in the dinosaur costume. So that's definitely one of those.
I was hoping you'd forget that, but thanks. Thanks for bringing that up. Yeah, both of these young men, I must say, have learned a lot. Obviously, have grown up a lot. One last question for you guys: what is your plans, Gavin? You can start. What are your plans now moving forward? What's your future look like?
So I've enlisted in the Navy, and so my ship date has been pushed back, but as of now, I will be assigned to a submarine.
That is awesome. That is cool. Alex?
So I am enlisted to the Army. My date also got pushed back, so I leave August 4th to go to Fort Leonard Wood, Missouri.
That's very awesome, too. Both these guys. Let's give them a round of applause. That's awesome. So just one last thing about both these gentlemen here. They both have the best hearts ever. I mean, I will tell you, like, Alex, I remember, like, your mission trip you went on, and you and your buddy with Steve, and just, the servant that you became through that trip, I'll never forget that. I mean, that is... I think that's helped mold you into the person you are. I mean, he's just an incredible young man, and I'm excited for what the future holds for you. Gavin, the same thing. I mean, there's not a time that I just know I could call you. I have before, and there's not. I mean, you do anything for anybody, and you're just a very helpful guy. You guys are both going to serve our country and do great things. So, really excited for that. This is the part that I don't look forward to because I have to give a guy a rose. But Alex, here's your rose, buddy. Yeah. And here you go, buddy. I've got a card for you here as well. Gavin? And Alex. All right, if you guys want to have a seat, we have a slideshow to show everybody now at this point. Thank you, guys.
You keep on walking till you find the window. If it's cold outside, show the world the warmth of your smile. But more than anything, my wish for you is that this life becomes all that you wanted till your dreams stay big, your worries stay small. You never you never forget all the ones who love you in the place you left. I hope you always forgive and you never regret, and you help somebody every chance you get. Oh, you find God's grace in every mistake, and always give more than you take. But more than anything, yeah, more than anything,
the same things They always ask me to come up and do announcements or preach right after something like that. And it's always a little difficult after that. But congratulations, Alex. Congratulations, Gavin. Both of you, I'm proud of you as your pastor. I'm very proud of you, young men. And I'm looking forward to hearing how your future goes. And I know I was watching the faces of both your parents. And I seen the excitement. I seen the tears. I better not look that way. Or your pastor's going to have tears as well. But we are proud of you as a congregation. And I hope this church, I hope I made an impact in your life as moving forward. As you can see, the mic is in front of me, and last week, as we did prayers and praises, that was a good thing, and it worked, but the people at home, as it's being videoed, had a difficult time hearing you, even though I repeated what you had actually said. So we're going to try something a little different this morning, just because we're doing things different these days due to the pandemic and trying to follow the guidelines. Obviously, we're not passing the mic as we typically did, but as you can see, the mic is up front, and we're asking, when I point out to your side, if you have a prayer or a praise, if you would just come to the mic and just say what that is, and then we'll pray for you that way. So what I'd like to do is we'll start on this side, my right, your left. If you have a prayer or a praise, if you would come to the mic, you can raise your hand and I'll acknowledge you, or you just come on up. And if I see none, Sue, you want to come up? And anyone else, just come on up right now. And then we'll go to this side when we're finished there.
A week ago tomorrow, B. Clayton came home from the hospital. Brian contacted us and said he was picking her up about 1 o'clock, and he'd like people to come in line the driveway and pray because she had been able to come home, which we did. We had signs and flowers and everything else there, and when they got to the corner of County Road 42 and 21, there was a friend of theirs, a police officer, that gave him a police escort the rest of the way. By the time she got to the driveway, she was sobbing because she'd seen all of us and she knew that we loved her and was caring about her. I got a message from Brian on Wednesday. The home health nurse was there and he had to take her back to the hospital. She needed blood. Her numbers were way down again. So please, please pray for her. She is at home with Brian and the girls, but she needs all of our prayers. Thank you.
Sue, who was the first one? The first one you mentioned?
B. Clayton.
Okay, thank you.
I just ask that you continue to pray for Tony. His fistula in his arm is not working, so tomorrow he's gonna have a procedure done where they're gonna put a camera up his arm. He has some blockage, so they're gonna put some kind of a liquid or something to try to get the blood clots thinned out. He's not in any kind of danger, but at this point we don't know if his fistula is gonna be workable. So tomorrow he's just gonna have that done to see if they can see anything else. So just keep him in your prayers, thanks.
Thank you, Chris. Any others on this side? Okay, I'm gonna move to this side, my left, your right. Anyone that wants to come up, if you have one or 10, just come on up now and go to the mic and we'll... Okay, I see none, but I do have a joy. I have a joy for next week. Derek and Jessica Gilreth are going to become members of Maple Grove. Next week, long before, before the pandemic hit, they expressed to me that they would like to become members here at Maple Grove with us. And due to the COVID-19, obviously, we weren't able to do that, but they are coming in next week. We're gonna have call them forward. They're gonna answer some questions, and they'll officially be a member of the Maple Grove Church, and we praise God for that. And I guess I'm putting it out to you, anyone that has been thinking about that, or would like, if you're not a member and would like to become one, see me and we can perhaps make that happen. So it's good to see everybody in the house of the Lord this morning, and for those that are worshiping with us online, we give praise for you as well as a church body, and we can't wait till the day when we can all come back and worship together in the house of the Lord. So with that being said, let us bow our heads with a word of prayer. Our gracious and heavenly Father, we certainly live on certain times. We hear of the pandemic almost every day and what's going on, the numbers that continue to increase, even though it kind of steadied out a little bit. And we just and we hear about the riots in the cities, Lord, and but this is nothing new to you. You know about it. You knew about it. And Lord, our prayer is that you would take this pandemic away, that you would give mankind the wisdom to come up with a cure, and that we can all come back to work and to the churches and social activities, Lord. And we just pray for that. We pray for our cities, our mayors and our governors, our president, vice president, Lord, all in leadership positions. We pray that you would grant unto them wisdom to make good decisions for us, the people, Lord. And we just thank you for that as well. We think of those people, some in our own congregation that lost loved ones. And we think of Dave and Marla and the passing of his mom over a week ago now. We just continue to lift that family up. Lord, we pray for those that were mentioned here this morning. We think of Tony that has surgery tomorrow. And we pray for him. And we pray for continued healing for those that had surgery, for Gary, Bobby, and Randy Sizemore. And Lord, we pray for them as well. And we lift up our dear sister, B. Clayton, Lord, and we just pray for her. And just she just loves you with her heart and her soul and her mind and all her strength. Lord, as she has gone back into the hospital, we pray that you would give the doctors and nurses wisdom. We're praying for a miracle in her life, and all those that battle cancer, Lord, and those that are near and dear to us, and those that we pray for regularly, we lift them up. And Lord, this morning we're happy that we can gather together as a church, and the doors are now open, and we can worship you. We pray for those brothers and sisters that are watching online, that someday they can be back with us too, and we look so forward to that day. Lord, we thank you for the birth, not only what happened, we mentioned death and we're sad for that, but Lord, we're also thankful. We're thankful for those that gave birth, and we mentioned last week of Gray Dunlap, Michael and Crystal Dunlap's daughter, Lord. We thank you for her birth, and Lord, we thank you for the graduates that we got to honor here this morning, for Alex Becker and Gavin Erb, Lord, and thank you, Lord. It's certainly been an unusual year for them, and Lord, they're such two young men, and I am so proud of them. I know this congregation is as well. We just wish the best for both of them as they enter the military, and Lord, we're thankful for their service. We think of Elise Sharkey as well. She graduated from college, Lord. We ask your blessings upon her and all that she does. And Lord, we thank you for Derek and Jessica, and just thank you that they made the determination, Lord, they want to join Maple Grove, and we're just thankful for them and ask your blessings upon them. And all of us moving forward, Lord, we're here today, as we always are, to honor and glorify you in all we say and all we do. We pray that we would do that, Lord, and we pray it in Jesus' name, amen. If you have your Bibles, I'd ask you to open them. There's pew Bibles, and some I know you use your device. Some of you have your Bibles that you brought with you, and that's good. I would encourage you each week to bring your Bibles and follow along as we go through our scripture text, which comes from the book of Revelation this morning, chapter 2. We're going to look at verse 1 to 7. This is what John has to say through Jesus Christ. Verse 1 says, "To the angel of the church of Ephesus write, these are the words of him who holds the seven stars in his right hand and walks among the seven golden lampstands. I know your deeds, your hard work, and your perseverance. I know that you cannot tolerate wicked men, that you have tested those who claim to be apostles but are not, and have found them to be false. You have persevered and have endured hardship for my name, and have not grown weary. Yet I hold this against you. You have forsaken your first love. Remember the height from which you have fallen. Repent and do the things you did at first. If you do not repent, I will come to you and remove your lampstand from its place. But you have this in your favor. You hate the practice of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit has to say to the churches. To him who overcomes, I will give him the right to eat from the tree of life, which is in the paradise of God. This ends our scripture text reading here this morning. Last week, we finished a series called How To. It was a four-week series, and I actually could have continued it maybe this week on how to do church, how to do church. And we look at the seven churches we're going to look at throughout this series, and this series called The Seven Churches. It is in the book of Revelation, and these seven churches that we're going to look at come from chapter 2 and chapter 3 of the book of Revelation. And then from chapter 4 to chapter 22, it talks about the coming events in the book of Revelation. The author of this book is the Apostle John. And John is recording this message from Jesus Christ himself. So if you have your Bibles and you have them open, and if you have red letter edition, you will take notice that these words are in red letter. That means these words come from Jesus Christ, directly from him. And John is just penning them down for him. John records what Jesus sees. In other words, Jesus is the overseer. He's looking down. He knows all things. He's God. He sees it and he says, John, this is what I want you to write about what I'm seeing about these seven churches. It would be like me giving an evaluation of churches here in New Paris. Let's pick seven churches. And I would ask Tonda Carrick, which is our church secretary, I would say, Tonda, this is what I want you to write about the seven churches and how I see them in my eyes here in New Paris. The Methodist Church, the Nazarene Church, the Missionary Church, the Brethren Churches, and so on. So Jesus gives these churches an evaluation, okay? It would be like when I worked at the township, Springsbury Township, for 14 years. Every year, I would get an evaluation. My boss would call me into his office, and he'd say, Dwayne, this is what I think that you are doing well. But on the other hand, this is what I think you can improve on. You're doing maybe a little okay, but you can improve in this area. We have ministerial meetings here about four or five times a year. And the ministerial team says, Dwayne, this is what I think the congregation, the church is doing well. This is what I think you're doing well. This is what maybe you can work on just a little bit better. And it's always good. It's good constructive criticism. And that's what Jesus here is giving, right, having John pen to giving criticism, good things that they're doing, he says, but he says, then I have this to say about you. And we'll see that as we go on, to give them constructive criticism so they can get better. You see, Jesus may see what we don't see. Growing up, I always enjoyed watching. I'd have two favorite parts of the newspaper. One part of the newspaper, the first, when I opened it up, I'd always look at the sports section. That was just me. I looked at the sports. The second thing I would go to is the comic strip, okay? Now that I'm older, it kind of changes. Not that we have a lot of newspapers, but I look at the obituaries. It just tells you my age, okay? But when I was growing up, I liked to watch the Charlie Brown Peanuts comic strip. How many of you used to like to watch that or read that, okay? Charlie Brown was one of my favorite characters growing up. But Charlie Brown in the one comic strip, they were laying on their back, both of them, and they were looking up into the sky, okay? And they seen the cloud formation. And you know how that is when you're driving down the road or you're out for a walk and you look up in the clouds and you say, man, that looks like a dog over here, okay? Or this looks like a hotel. And our minds just go, they go different ways. And then Karen will say, well, I don't see it. It don't look like a dog to me. It looks more like whatever, you know, but we're always on the other end of the page, it seems. We see things differently, right? So Lucy asked Charlie Brown, "Charlie, what do you see?" And before he even had a chance to respond, Lucy says this. She says, "I see Stephen, the first martyr that was killed for his faith. I see him being stoned to death. That's what I see over here. And over here," she says, "I see Prince Henry, the navigator. That's what I see over there." She goes, "What do you see, Charlie?" And he gets that big gulp. He goes, "Well, what I was going to say is I seen a horsey and a ducky." He said, "But now that you said that," he goes, "I've changed my mind," he said. So as a nation, as a community, as a church, what does God see? What does he see? Does he see the same thing that you and I see, or does he see something different? To see what Jesus sees, we need to have the same set of eyes that he has. We have to have the same set of ears that he has to listen and to see what he is seeing. You see, Charlie Brown and Lucy were looking at the exact same sky, but they saw two different things. The Apostle John, as he's writing this letter, he's on the island of Patmos, where now he's an old man, and he's writing down, as we said earlier, what Jesus wanted him to write and what he told him to write. He tells him, "I want you to write about seven churches, okay, and seven different letters, to one to each church, okay?" And this church, all these churches were in Asia Minor, which is present-day Turkey. They were real churches. They were historical churches that existed in time. And every single church represents one of us today throughout the age of the church. The first church that we're going to look at here this morning, it comes from chapter 2, starting at verse 1, is the church of Ephesus. And he starts out in the first part of chapter 2, verse 1, the first part of that verse, he says this: "To the angel of the church of Ephesus write." So here's Jesus, and he's telling John, this, "I want you to write this down." So when he talks about the angel, who is the angel? The angel can be considered a messenger. Okay, what he means, that messenger is the pastor of the church, or the elders. Okay, that's who he's writing to. To the pastors, the elders, "This is what I want you to write down. This is what I want you to see." So before we go any further, let's look at a little bit of history of this city of Ephesus and the church of Ephesus. Paul started the church, okay? Paul's the one that started this church in Ephesus on his third missionary journey. If you have your Bibles, or sometime later, you want to turn to the book of Acts, chapter 19. It tells you all about it. It tells you about what Paul started, how he started this church, and how this church, even though they did many things wrong at the time, the city did, Paul, through the Holy Spirit, turned it upside down. Turned it upside down, and a great revival took place. In that Acts chapter 19, if you look at verse 11, and we don't have it on the screen here this morning, but you see, it was such a revival that Paul, when his handkerchief fell from his pocket, those that were sick or those who were demon-possessed would run up and pick up that handkerchief, okay? And they would be healed by the Holy Spirit. God would heal them. And then you go down a couple verses later, and it talks about Demetrius. And Demetrius was not a Christian. He was a silversmith. And what happened? Christianity was growing so much in the city of Ephesus that he was losing business because he made idols out of silver and different things. And so all these people would come from out of the city, from different places, and even in the city, they would buy these idol worships because Christianity was growing so much. His business started to go way down. Okay, he started to lose business. So he incurred, and he got these group of people, and guess what they did? They started to riot. Read chapter 19. So when you think the riots in our major city is something new, it's not. Okay, nothing is new under the sun. This happened way back in the city of Ephesus, way back in Paul's day. It was an important city. They had four major roads coming into the city, okay? They had a harbor that was very important to their business, just like New York City or Boston and those that have big harbors. Ephesus was the same way. It was good for their business. It was also considered a free city. And that simply meant, as a free city, that there was no Roman soldiers in the city, okay? A free city also had a center of godless worship, the godless worship of Diana, okay? So what was that worship like? Well, it's hard to believe what the worship was like back in those days, but there were prostitutes in the temple, okay? There was prostitutes in the temple, there were orgies that took place, sexual perversion, and the list went on in the church. In the midst of all these bad things, the church is born. Again, revival takes place, and the city starts to be turned upside down. The letter here is addressed, as we mentioned earlier, it's addressed to the pastors, it's addressed to the elders. But the addresser, who is the addresser? We talked about it. It's none other than Jesus Christ. He is the addresser. And this is what he says in the other part of verse 1. He says, "These are the words of him who holds the seven stars in his right hand and walks among the golden lampstands." So again, the person we see is Jesus Christ. And this is what he says to the church. If you look at verse 2 and you look at verse 3, this is what he says to the church. "I know your deeds." See, you and I, we can't hide anything from God, from Jesus, okay? He knows what happens here at Maple Grove. He goes, "I know your deeds, Maple Grove. I know your deeds. I know your hard work and your perseverance. I know that you cannot tolerate wicked men, and that you have tested those who claim to be apostles but are not, and have found them to be false." He says in verse 3, "You have persevered and have endured hardship for my name and have not grown weary." You see, Christ commends them for many things here in these two verses. He commends them he says in the first part of verse 2, "Your hard work. I commend you for your hard work." And as your pastor here at Maple Grove, I commend you, Maple Grovers, for your hard work. This was a church that worked hard for the Lord. Unlike John MacArthur once said about many Christians today who serve, as he says, wouldn't exhaust a butterfly. They wouldn't exhaust a butterfly. And then he goes on to say, he says, "Too many Christians today just want to be entertained." Too many Christians today just want to be entertained. Monday morning, I had a dentist appointment, and my dental hygienist was telling me, because she knew I was a pastor, and she asked if we opened yet. And I said, "Yeah, we opened up last week." And she said, "Her church has been open, but they did outdoor services, and they planned many, many neat things." It was really cool what she told me they did. She said it was almost like a carnival experience. They had entertainment for the kids. They had slushies for the kids. They had food. They just had all these fun things for the kids. And I don't have anything against that. That is great. But what I think of is when we go back to regular church, will we want to be entertained? We're not here to be entertained. We're here to worship the Lord and to give him honor and glory. And then he gives them another praise in verse 3. He says, he talks about their perseverance, how they persevered. In other words, this church did not give up. When they said they were going to do something, they followed through with it and they actually did it. They persevered and they endured hardship for the name of Jesus Christ. And he goes on to say in verse 2, the latter part of verse 2, "You cannot tolerate wicked men." He says, you cannot tolerate, in other words, sin. Those who do things wrong. Sin that comes in the church, that they dealt with it head on. Okay, when they knew there was a sin in the church, something going amiss, they dealt with it head on. He says in the latter part of verse 2 as well, "You have tested those who claim to be apostles and are not, and you have found them to be false." In other words, this church was given because they followed the word of God, because they followed Christ, they had spiritual discernment. And the only way to stand against false teachings is to know the truth. We have to know the truth to be able to stand against false teachings. And that's why it is so important to be in the Word of God. Not only here at church, we're in the Word of God, and you have your Bibles open, and we're preaching to you, and you're listening, and we have Sunday school, you have Zoom. That's all very important, but it's also important to have private devotions, to be in the Word of God, So when false teachings come along, the red flags will go up immediately and say, that's not true. That's not right. You know the best way to find out what a counterfeit bill is, a dollar or $5 or $20, is to know the real thing. To know the real thing. And then you will be able to pick a counterfeit out quickly. And speaking of counterfeits, look what Christ says about them. If you jump to verse 6 of our text this morning, he said, but you have this in your favor. He's given them another praise here, this church. This is what you have in your favor, he says. You hate the practice of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. So he's saying, you hate the practice of the Nicolaitans, okay? So who are these guys? Who are these Nicolaitans? These Nicolaitans people are the ones that settled in the city of Ephesus under the rule of Nicholas. They taught that you could do just about anything. Eat, drink, and be merry. If it makes you happy, go ahead and do it. If you want a riot in the major cities, go ahead and do it. If you don't want to pay cash or by credit card, just go in and loot it and take it out. Eat, drink, and be happy. No rules, okay? This was the practice of the Nicolaitans. You see, there's nothing new under the sun. The Church of Ephesus hated what God hates, okay? The Church of Ephesus hated what God hated. What a great church this was. And that's not all. They had some of the best leadership of their day available to them. Think of Paul, okay? Remember, on his third missionary journey, he started this church of Ephesus. If they had a wall of pastors, all the pastors that ever ministered in that church, and they had their picture on the wall, you know, Paul would be the first one. There's Paul. And then comes along young Timothy, a great man of God. There's Timothy's picture. And then they had Apollos, okay? Apollos was a great man of God. They said this man could preach. He could really preach the word of God. And then you had people in their leadership, Aquila and Priscilla, great people of God. This church was a thriving church. They worked hard and they didn't grow weary, okay? They didn't grow weary. Ephesus, as I mentioned, was a good church. In verse 4, it says, yet I hold this against you. Okay? They were thriving. They were doing good. This church looked like it had it all together, didn't it? And I think they did for a time. But yet, God, we can't keep secrets from Him. We can't keep secrets from Jesus. He said, yet this is what I hold against you. In verse 4, how tragic. Ephesus was a very good church, but it had fallen out of love with Jesus Christ. And it didn't happen overnight. It's like churches today. I believe that, and I'm just going to pick on our denomination and our district maybe. Our church, I know every single church started out good. I really believe that they started out on ground level. They praised Jesus. There was only one way to get to heaven. That was through Jesus Christ. But over time and over what society says, they gradually gave into that. And now what some of these churches are saying, there's multiple ways to heaven, that Jesus isn't the only way to get there anymore. So what that tells me is they took their eyes off of Jesus and they're looking at all these other ways, these other idols. And over time, you know, they fell out of love with their first love, which was Jesus Christ. You know, we as Christians, you know, growing up and even maybe today, you know, we think adultery is wrong. We think fornication is wrong. We think gay marriages are wrong. We think all these things are wrong. But then when somebody in our family goes through that, sometimes we just say, well, maybe the Bible doesn't mean that. And we gradually start to believe maybe the other way. Several years ago, there was a couple. They were vacationing in Florida, husband and wife. And as they were there in Florida, they thought that, you know, they were laying on the beach and they thought, well, let's take a raft and let's go out to the ocean. Let's get a couple rays out there in the ocean. So they were there and getting some nice rays and the nice cool water there. And the husband said, you know, I had enough. I'm going to go in. I'm just going to relax on the beach. And the wife decided, I'm just going to stay here a little bit longer. Well, the drift eventually carried her out farther and farther and farther. And actually, her life was in jeopardy. that they were able to rescue her, the lifeguards were able to rescue her, but it became a very tense situation. In other words, what this lady did is she got just a little bit careless while she was out laying and relaxing. Christ says, I want you to remember. He says, I want you to remember. Let me go back a little bit. We must be careful, all of us. We must be careful that we don't become careless by just coasting along in our spiritual walk. Because like I said before, it doesn't happen overnight. In Hebrews chapter 2, verse 1, he says, we must pay more careful attention, therefore, to what we have heard so that we do not drift away. So, how do we know if we're drifting away? How do you and I as Christians, how do we know if we're drifting away? What does it look like? How do we know if we're leaving our first love? Well, let me give you some ideas. There's more than this, but let me give you three. When we don't grieve over our sin anymore and we rationalize it away as just being a human being. Number two, when we're more concerned about pleasing others rather than pleasing God. Number three, when we're unable to forgive another person. So the question I ask myself, the question I ask you is, have we left our first love? Are there warning signs that we need to heed? A story is told of a husband and wife, and they're dating. Before they became husband and wife, obviously they're dating, and early on in their marriage, they had one of the pickup trucks where it was a single cab. We remember they still have them today. And a lot of times you've seen the couple sitting shoulder to shoulder in the truck. And one day after they were married several years, the wife asked her husband, why don't we sit like that anymore? And the husband turned and looked to her and said, who moved? Who moved? So if you don't feel close to God this morning, ask yourself the question, who moved? Which one? I can guarantee you it wasn't God that moved. In Revelation, in verse 5, chapter 2, verse 5, he says this, remember the heights from which you have fallen. Repent and do the things you did at first. If you do not repent, I will come to you and remove your lampstand from its place. Okay, so kind of he's rebuking them. He's calling them out here. Okay, it kind of reminds me of a joke that I just heard. And the joke goes like this. Why did Noah have to punish the chickens on the ark? Why did Noah have to punish the chickens on the ark? Okay, because they were using foul language. Okay, they were using. I hope that's not the only thing you remember about this message. But Christ says, I want you to remember. I want you to remember what it was like. Rekindle your faith. Rekindle what it was like when you first became a Christian, when you first had that light in you. Remember your behavior and how you started to change. You see, spiritual defection always begins with a lousy memory. Spiritual defection comes with a lousy memory. It's so easy to forget what God has done for us, and that's nothing new. All you have to do is read the Old Testament. Open your Bibles, read the Old Testament, and you see how the nation of Israel remembered God, okay? And they were close to God. And all of a sudden, they forgot all the things that God had done for them. And then they went backwards, okay? Good king, bad king, bad king, good king. The history of the Old Testament, how God blessed them, and they remembered, and they came to God. And then over time, they drifted. They drifted out to sea. They drifted. And they became disconnected with God. God not only wants us to remember, God also wants us to repent. What he tells us, what that tells me when he says he wants us to repent, it is a sin. From what I'm getting out of this scripture, is not to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. So if we're not doing that, he's saying, what I want you to do is I want you to repent. You see, if we love anything more than we love Jesus Christ, if it's your will to be done instead of God's will, then what happened is you left your first love. And if that's true, he's asking us to repent. After remembering and after repenting, then we have to return. We have to come back. If you go back to what you used to do or what you should have done when you first became a Christian, remember that? Those days you were excited, you prayed to God. Okay, you studied your Bible, you fellowshiped with other people, you shared your testimony because you were so excited and what God was doing in your life. Now, many of you here this morning know who Vince Lombardi was. Vince Lombardi was a longtime coach of the Green Bay Packers. And the Green Bay Packers were going through a time where Vince Lombardi didn't think they were playing up to their potential. So he called a team meeting, and he called the whole team in, and he held this little thing called a football. And he said, gentlemen, this is a football, okay? What he was trying to do is get them back to basics, get them back to where their first love. Christ is saying to the church, he's calling us together as a church. And he says, church, this is what I want you to do. I want you to remember. Remember what I've done for you. I want you to repent if repentance is needed. And then I want you to return. You see, the church of Ephesus, unfortunately, started to become cold and started to become distant from God, going in the wrong direction. But God did not give up on them. That's the neat thing about God. He never gives up on us. He didn't give up on the church. He doesn't give up on Maple Grove. And he doesn't give up on you. He's our Savior and he's our coach. In verse 7, he goes on to say, he who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To him who overcomes, I will give the right to eat from the tree of life, which is in the paradise of God. You see, the tree of life once existed in the Garden of Eden. The tree of life someday is coming back. It's coming back. And us as Christians are going to eat from the tree of life someday. Christ is saying, we've all got a set of ears. Everyone that I'm looking at here this morning, I think some have ears. You all have ears. Some of you have hair that's covering it. Some of you have big ears like me. Some of you have small ears. But we all have ears to hear. We can't pass that on as if God is talking to somebody else. And I see some of you snapping each other's ears. You don't want to do that here. Okay. 1 John chapter 5. 1 John chapter 5, verse 5 says this. He who overcomes the world, Who is it that overcomes the world? Only he who believes that Jesus is the Son of God. Believe is more than head knowledge. Believing is more than head knowledge. It's more than knowing the facts about Jesus Christ and about God. It's trusting him and loving him with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. It's living in obedience to him. It's being a doer of the word and not just a hearer of the word. As Christians, Lucy asked Charlie Brown, what do you see, Charlie? What do you see in the cloud formation? The two of them saw something different, totally different. So what does God see when he evaluates Maple Grove Church? What does he see? Does he see something that we don't see? What does he see when he evaluates you? The blessings are ours when we look through spiritual eyes. Let us pray. Our gracious and our heavenly Father, I thank you, Lord, for penning this letter to John so that our ears could hear. And we could evaluate ourselves, do a self-evaluation of where we are with you in our Christian life, where we are with you as a church. And Lord, if we're going astray or going amiss, or you have to say, I love you, Maple Grove, but this I have against you. I pray that, Lord, you would reveal that to us so that we can get better, that we can press on, Lord, and honor and glorify you even more. Lord, I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
We're going to end the service today with a song called The Blessing, and it's one that maybe isn't real familiar with all of you, but it's just such a great one to sing over our graduates this morning. And so we just want to invite you to stand and join with us this morning as we pray the blessing today. The Lord bless you and keep you and make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. The Lord bless you and keep you, make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you.
And your family and your children and their children and their children.
May his presence go before you and behind you and beside you, all around you and within you. He is with you, he is with you.
In the morning,
in the evening,
in the coming,
and your going,
and your weeping,
and rejoicing.
He is for you,
he is for you,
he is for you, he is for you, he is for you, he is for you, he is for you, he is for you. His favor be upon you, and a thousand generations, and your family, and your children, and their children.
Faithful servant. Someday, when the Lord calls us home, he's going to say, well done, good and faithful servant. Keep up the good work, Maple Grove. God bless you.